गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी, नमस्ते, वेलकम टू अनदर इवनिंग ऑफ इंटीग्रेटिव हेल्थ एजुकेशन सीरीज, एंड दिस इज पार्ट ऑफ द बायोलॉजी फॉर नॉन बायोलॉजिस्ट, एंड वी हैव डिस्टिंग्विश्ड गेस्ट विद अस, डॉक्टर अश्विन दलाल एंड आवर पीएचडी स्टूडेंट फॉर पंजाब यूनिवर्सिटी प्रिया मेहरा, एंड वी होप टू गेन अ लॉट ऑफ फीडबैक आफ्टर यू लिसन टू दिस प्रोग्राम्स रेगुलरली. यू जस्ट हैव टू बी देयर फॉर 15-20 मिनट्स, इंटरैक्ट एंड गिव योर थॉट्स. The program is being coordinated by Dr. Manjari Ryan, whom you can see here, as well as Dr. Parul Bali, and they run this through various elementary and fundamental concepts of biology, which are so important for research, practice. You are Ayush practitioners, you are yoga practitioners, and you are doing your practice, but we need to bring this to the research level, validate it, and do molecular biomedical investigations of your interventions that you're doing. And with that thought, Manjari and Parul brought this series to you. So without much ado, I will hand over the stage to Manjari, who can take the proceedings forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Akshay. So, good evening, everyone, and welcome again to the biology series. So, today's speaker with us is Priya Mehra, who is doing PhD from Punjab University. She'll be talking about another aspect of central dogma, that is transcription. Right now, she is interested in rescuing the retinal injury using stem cells. With her, we are also joined by our commentator today, Dr. Ashwin Dalal, who is a staff scientist at the Center of DNA Fingerprinting and Diagnostic Hyderabad and head of Diagnostic Division. He is recipient of gold medal in his MBBS. He did his post-graduation in pediatrics from Goa Medical College, Goa University, followed by super specialization in medical genetics from Sanjay Gandhi Postgraduate Institute of Medical Sciences, Lucknow. His lab, Genetic Diagnostic Laboratory at CDFD, offers comprehensive diagnosis, genetic counseling, and prenatal diagnosis of genetic diseases. He was instrumental in establishment of Department of Medical Genetics at Nizam's Institute of Medical Sciences, Hyderabad. He is also adjunct visiting professor in the Department of Medical Genetics, Kasturba Medical College, Manipal, India. He is founding member and past secretary of Society for Indian Academy of Medical Genetics. He has published over 100 papers, and his research interests include identification of novel genes for single gene disorder and molecular analysis of genetic disease. So by saying this, I welcome Dr. Ashwin Dalal to share some importance of transcription, and then we'll be moving on with our presentation. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. And thank you, Dr. Akshay, for inviting me. So it's really nice to see these small presentations that you are having, which really it is important both for the biologists as well as the non-biologists to kind of get used to this information of the newer genomic technologies that are coming up, because now genomics or the genetic knowledge is not confined only to the research laboratories. It is actually coming right into the diagnosis as well as treatment of many of these genetic diseases. And that's why it is very important that we don't think of these studies as just like some research which happens in some laboratories and remains there. We are actually seeing the application of these advances. And that is why it is very important that the students or the clinicians in this field are well aware of at least the basics in this field. And today, what Priya is going to discuss is one of the important parts of the central dogma that we know of in genetics. So that the topic being transcription. So we'll hear from Priya regarding the basics of transcription, how transcription happens and all. And then at the end, probably I'll try and show you how the principles of transcriptions are being used in both diagnostics as well as in treatment of some of the genetic diseases that newer treatments are coming based on the principles which are employed in the understanding transcription. So I request Priya to begin her presentation.
Thank you, sir. I'll share my presentation.
Yes.
Can I start now?
Yes.
Good evening, everyone. Today we will discuss about transcription. In the last lecture, which is given by Dr. Manjari, she has explained how replication occurs. Now, after replication, how transcription occurs. Today, we will discuss about the factors which are responsible for transcription and various steps are involved in the transcription. So, firstly, the features of transcription is it is a highly selective process. Many of the RNA transcripts are synthesized as a precursor known as a primary transcript. Transcription is a process by which the information in the strand of DNA is copied into the new form of new molecule of mRNA. So, transcription occurs at different sites. So, occurrence of transcription in prokaryotes and eukaryotes are different. In prokaryotes, transcription occurs in the cytoplasm, whereas in eukaryotes, it occurs in the nucleus. The enzymes which are involved in transcription in both prokaryotes and eukaryotes are different. In prokaryotes, the holoenzymes are present. This is the subunits of these enzymes, that is alpha, beta, beta dash, omega, and sigma, are combination of both five subunits are called as holoenzymes, whereas combination of alpha, beta, beta dash, and omega are the pore enzymes, which are responsible for the elongation. Whereas sigma perform very important function in the recognition of promoter and initiate the transcription. The function of alpha is assembly of pore enzymes and promoter recognition, whereas beta and beta dash have a catalytic activity and also involved in the elongation of of chain. Whereas omega is responsible for the assembly of RNA polymerase. In eukaryotic, different RNA polymerase are present. First is RNA polymerase 1, RNA polymerase 2, RNA polymerase 3. And it requires various transcription factors to initiate the eukaryotic transcription. So I'll discuss about the transcription factor later on. So transcription in prokaryotes, the first step is the initiation step, second step is the elongation step, and the third step is the termination step. So in the first step, when the RNA, the holoenzyme gets bonded to the RNA polymerase, it will form the transcription bubble that will convert the closed complex into the open complex once the RNA polymerase gets bonded. That will result in the rebinding or unbinding of DNA through the enzyme called unbinding is done by the enzyme called helicase, whereas rebinding of DNA occurs by the enzyme called topoisomerase 1. So after that, once the initiation gets executed, it will lead to the elongation. In the elongation step, the new nucleotides get incorporated at the 3' end. As we can see in the existing RNA transcript, new nucleotides get incorporated at the 3' end, and the chain get elongated. Once the chain get elongated, it will lead to the termination. The termination in prokaryotes occur by the two methods. First is the row dependent method, second is the row independent method. So as the name suggests, row dependent means it depends upon the row protein, whereas independent means it does not involve any row protein to involve for the termination. So row dependent means that the row protein will came and it will bind to the specific site where RNA-DNA hybrid will form. At that site, the row will cut onto that site and it will release the RNA from DNA. As we can see, the RNA gets separated from the DNA. So this is how the termination will occur, whereas in row independent pathway, which is also called as intrinsic pathway, in this method of palindromic sequences are present. With palindromic sequences are basically a conserved sequences, which are rich in GC-rich sequences. So they will form a hairpin loop-like structure. At that site, they are rich. They will incorporate the uracil unit onto it. And once RNA polymerase reaches the site, it will get RNA polymerase get free from the template and the termination will occur. So transcription in eukaryote, as I have already discussed about different types of RNA polymerase involved in the eukaryotics, RNA polymerase 1, RNA polymerase 2, and RNA polymerase 3. It is very complicated process in case of eukaryotics, and it involves different transcription factor. So most important point in eukaryotic transcription is that before initiation, pre-initiation complex is formed with the help of these promoters. These are generally called as general transcription factors. So there are six transcription factors which are involved in pre-initiation complex. The pre-initiation complex is important because it will recruit the RNA polymerase and allow the binding of to transcribe the RNA. So the first is the transcription factor D. The transcription factor, the main function of transcription factor D is to recognize the Tata box where the conserved sequences are present. Here the Tata box is, as we can see in the Tata box, is Tata sequence are present. So transcription factor D will recognize the Tata box through this transcription factor A, which will stabilize the transcription factor D, and transcription factor B. Transcription factor B will recruit the RNA polymerase. When these transcription factor A and B form a complex with transcription factor D, it will another transcription factor will come with the RNA polymerase, that is transcription factor F, that will recruit the RNA polymerase and bind to the complex, that is resulting complex is bonded by RNA polymerase attached to transcription factor F. After that, the transcription E factor, that will recruit the transcription factor H, and main function of transcription factor H is the promoter clearance once the RNA polymerase get incorporated into the complex. So so transcription factor 2H will remove the promoter, and RNA get separated from the complex by the process of phosphorylation. For this, it requires the ATP, and after that, the transcription gets started. So here we can see that the pre-initiation complex get formed. After that, the transcription factor H will bond it to it. And when the transcription factor H will bond it, the promoter will get separated from the RNA polymerase. And the RNA polymerase undergo the phosphorylation. After that, the transcription gets started. So next step after initiation, the next step is the elongation. Once the initiation gets started, so new nucleotide get incorporated. As we can see, NTP get incorporated at the 3' end of RNA strand. So as the new nucleotide incorporated, so the chain get elongated, and at a specific point when the chain get enough strand, so there is a termination will occur. So the termination in eukaryotes occur by the two methods. First is the torpedo method. Second is the allosteric method. So in the A figure is the torpedo method. In the torpedo method, the gene is present, which is RAT1HXRN3. It has the RNA's activity. When it bonded to the strand, it will signal the poly A tail for the detachment. So once when the RNA that one attached to the poly A tail, it will separate the strand and the RNA gets separated from the main strand. So in B figure, that is, this is the allosteric method. In this, there is a conformational changes occur that will result in the termination of the strand. So after that, once the RNA gets transcribed, splicing occurs. Splicing means when the strand contains all exons and introns. That is, it contains intron coding region also and non-coding region also. So to remove the non-coding region, splicing is the best way to remove the non-coding region. So through splicing, the intron gets removed and we get the mature mRNA. So in splicing, there are various methods are involved. So transplicing is there, alternative splicing is there, post-translation modification. These are the steps of post-translation modification where 5' capping is done, polyadenylation is done. 5' capping is important so that the mRNA does not get degraded. It can transport from nucleus to the cytoplasm. And in case of polyadenylation, is important because it will stabilize the strand. So that's why polyadenylation is important. So next is the difference between prokaryotic and eukaryotic transcription. As I have already told you that in prokaryotics, it occurs in the cytoplasm, whereas in eukaryotics, it occurs in the nucleus. The most important point is in prokaryotics, transcription and translation occur simultaneously in the cytoplasm, whereas in eukaryotics, transcription and post-transcription occur in the nucleus, whereas translation occur in the cytoplasm. In prokaryotes, there is no pre-initiation complex formed, though no definite phase of occurrence occur, whereas in eukaryote, pre-initiation complex formed in the G1 and G2 phase, which are the cell cycle phases. So after that, RNA polymerase are synthesized mRNA, tRNA, and rRNA, whereas in eukaryotics, RNA polymerase 1, 2, and 3 are involved, which synthesize rRNA, mRNA, tRNA, respectively. In prokaryotes, no initiation factor is required, whereas in eukaryotes, most importantly, initiation factors are required to recognize the Tata box. These are polycystronic method. It involves a polycystronic method, whereas in eukaryote, it involves a monocystronic transcription. So monocystronic transcription basically is a transcription unit that carries the information of just one gene, whereas polycystronic contains the information of set of genes. Next is the difference between replication and transcription. As earlier Dr. Manjari explained about the replication. So the difference between transcription and translation is in replication, both strands are required and the replication occurs into the whole genome, whereas in transcription, single-stranded DNA, RNA is present and only the small portion of genome gets transcribed. Primer is required in replication, whereas no primer is required in the transcription. Enzymes which are involved in replication are DNA polymerase, whereas in transcription, these are RNA polymerase. The end product which are formed is double-stranded DNA, whereas in transcription is single-stranded RNA. The base pairing is AT and GC, whereas in transcription, it's AU and AG. As Kanupriya has explained about this base pairing in DNA and RNA lecture. So you can see that lecture for more information. Proofreading, as Dr. Manjari has also explained how proofreading occur in the replication. Proofreading occur in the replication. So no proofreading occur in the transcription. Thank you.
Thank you, Priya. Now I request Dr. Ashwin to give his comment.
Yeah, so thank you, Priya, for nicely explaining the process of transcription both in prokaryotes and eukaryotes. Although it's a quite complex procedure, but we can understand it in simple ways, how transcription happens wherein RNA is produced from a strand of DNA and which will be used for production of protein. So as I told you in beginning, although we feel that these are all very basic kind of aspects, how do these aspects get applied into actual application for the patients with various genetic diseases? So if we have to see this, we can see it both in diagnostics as well as in newer therapies that are coming, which are based on these principles of transcription. So if you can see the slide.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so firstly, let us see about the diagnosis. So Priya has just now told us that the initial pre-mRNA is produced, which has both exons and introns. And during splicing, these introns, which are parts of the RNA, are removed. And ultimately, we have the mature mRNA, which only has the exons. Now, many things can go wrong due to mutations, which happens in patients with genetic diseases. So in case there is a mutation at the end of an exon or at the beginning of an exon, then proper splicing will not happen. So what splicing was supposed to happen here, the splicing will happen of this whole area. And that means this exon Y is lost and this protein will only have X and Z. So this is something called as exon skipping. So this can be one explanation which can lead to disease in the patient. or sometimes half of the exon may be included and the half of the exon is lost, or sometimes part of the intron gets included into the exons and then into the protein. So these all abnormalities lead to different genetic diseases, and we detect all these abnormalities while doing diagnostics for these genetic diseases. So it is important to understand the principles of transcription to then understand how abnormalities of transcription can lead to different diseases. Similarly, from the treatment point of view, the principles of transcription are used especially in treatment of two very common genetic disorders. One is the spinal muscular atrophy and other is the Duchenne muscular dystrophy. So in spinal muscular atrophy, what happens is that there are two genes in our body, SMN1 and SMN2. In normal individual, what happens is that SMN1 protein is produced from this particular gene, which has exons 1 to 8, whereas SMN2 produces mRNA, which is having this exon 7 missing. Okay, so this is because of a mutation present here. This particular exon is not included, and we have a protein which is produced from exon 1 to 8. Now, normally, that's why the SMN2 produces very less amount of protein. Now, what happens in a patient with spinal muscular atrophy is that this SMN1 gene is lost. So that means all protein produced by this gene is lost, and what the patient has is only a little protein which is produced by this particular gene. But this gene is having this exon 7 absent, and that is why it is not very functionally proper. So the patient has various clinical features like hypotonia, and usually they don't survive beyond 1 to 2 years. But a new type of therapy which has come up, which is the company is called Spinraza, and this therapy. In this therapy, what you use is that you use the allele-specific this antisense oligonucleotides here, which prevents the splicing of this exon out. And that's why you get more copies of this SMN2 protein, including the exon 7. And hence, the condition of the patient improves. So this drug has recently come into market, and already clinical trials are going for some of these centers in India also, and it has a very dramatic effect. Like children who would have died by the age of 1 or 2 years are now surviving much further, as well as they are able to function properly. So this is really a drastic kind of improvement that we see, and you can see that how the basics of transcription helped us to develop this particular kind of therapy. The second kind of therapy that was developed using this basis is the treatment for Duchenne muscular dystrophy. Now, Duchenne muscular dystrophy is another common disorder where either deletion or duplication of the exons leads to disease. So here what happens is that you can see that exon 43 is in this way and 44 is here. So these two pieces are fitting into each other. But if there is a deletion of this particular exon, then 43 cannot fit into 45, and hence it leads to something called as a frame shift. So this frame shift leads to the disease. So what we do in this exon skipping technology is that we use an antisense oligo, in which, because this 43 now, if we consider, so this 43 can fit into 44, but if 44 is exon is deleted, then 43 cannot fit into 45. But if 45 was absent, then 43 can fit into 46. So that is the whole point of this. So what we do is that exon 44 is absent in this patient. We use an antisense oligonucleotide, which prevents the transcription of exon 45. And hence, the splicing happens between 43 and 46. And then a normal protein can be produced with absence of just these two exons. Now that is, although it is doesn't make a totally normal, but it can convert the phenotype from a severe to a much milder phenotype. So we can see that these two types of treatments which have come up are totally based on our understanding of transcription, how transcription happens, and how we can apply it into treatment and diagnostics. So I feel that we all should understand this importance of knowing the basics of how the different life processes happen, so that it helps us to develop new diagnostic techniques, new therapeutic strategies. And that's the importance of basic science in our life. So thank you, all of you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. So I have a question. The medication in Spinraza, which was used, so does that have any other effect on other splicing of some other mRNAs, or it specifically attaches to?
No, this is a very specific kind of binding. So that is very important that this should not have effect on other mRNAs. Otherwise, there will be a lot of side effects. So this is a very specific kind of binding. It goes and binds only to the SMN2 protein. And as we know, it has to act on the brain. Hence, we have to give this drug intrathecally. That means into the cerebrospinal fluid. We cannot give it in blood. So these patients are given this drug every 15 days or every 2 months, depending on the dosing schedule. And then the antisense oligonucleotide goes into the neurons and produces this effect. So it's a very specific kind of one.
So they have to take this drug lifelong.
Yeah, that's right. So that is the disadvantage of this kind of drugs, that because it is our cellular machinery, that after some time this antisense oligonucleotide will be degraded. And hence, it has to be given repeated.
Okay, sir. So, when you are giving in CNS, does it affect the quality of life of the patients?
In a way, because these patients have to come to the hospital to take these medicines, which have to be given intrathecally, that means from the back, between the backbone, the injection is done. So in that way, the quality of life will be affected. But without medicine, their quality of life is too poor. They will have recurrent pneumonias. They don't survive beyond 1 year. They cannot sit. They cannot stand. They're just lying down. Whereas with the medicine, the life becomes much better for them. So in that sense, it really improves the quality.
Thank you, sir. So I would ask others also to ask questions.
Hello, Priyadi, I want to ask a basic question. Can this promoter are also transcribed into RNA, or these are excluded from the mRNA, or these are transcribed? The promoter region, that starter box and where these transcription factors bind, are these sequences also present in mRNA when
it is transcribed, or these are excluded from this?
These are present in the mRNA.
Okay.
I think, sir, you can answer Pooja's questions.
If you look at the structure of the gene, you have the promoter, and then you have the untranslated region, and then your gene. So promoter is the place where all these transcription factors will come and bind, and then the transcription will start
yes, sir.
From beyond the promoter. So promoter will not really be part of the mRNA, but it will basically include the untranslated region and the gene. So what you see in the mRNA basically is when you download it from the ensemble or something, you see the untranslated region, then the exons, introns. So that is the exons one after another and the untranslated regions. That is the whole mRNA that is produced. So promoter is the sequence where these all proteins will come and bind. It's a big complex that is formed. It's not a single, although we say it's RNA polymerase, but there are a lot of other proteins which have to come and bind there for transcription to start.
Okay, sir. I also want to ask that you have mentioned in one of your slides that in which exon 7 was absent, then that protein will be the same with less efficacy or less efficient function, or that will code for a different protein because one of the exon is absent in that sequence. So that will function as the same or that will become another protein or a non-functional protein?
So this SMN1 and SMN2, these are exactly same in the sequence except at two places there is a difference. So that's why SMN2 is called as a pseudogene of SMN1. Okay. So SMN1 is the one which produces the normal protein. SMN2 is the pseudogene because it has accumulated these mutations, because of which exon 7 does not get included into the mRNA. Hence, the protein that is produced by this is much less efficacious. Okay, and these mRNAs also don't get translated. So, absence of exon 7 leads to this SMN2 being a useless protein. That's why we call it as a pseudogene.
Okay.
But what is seen is that little protein also. So sometimes people have multiple copies of SMN2. Like, so because these are all in evolution, these have developed as duplicated genes. So SMN1, SMN2. Now some people have, normally people have two copies of SMN1, two copies of SMN2, one on each chromosome. Okay. But some people may have three copies or four copies of SMN2. And in such cases, it is seen that the disease becomes milder because all the protein that is produced, although it is less functional, a lot of less functional protein leads to some amount of functions. So that was the whole principle of, because SMN1 is totally absent in these patients who have, it's a gene deletion. So the treatment tries to create more of SMN2, which is functional, which is including the exon 7. And that way, we hope that the symptoms, it doesn't make totally normal. The patient doesn't become totally normal, but it makes the patient much better because little that SMN2 is coming.
Okay, sir, one last question, that can the intron of one gene can be the exon of another gene, or introns of one gene are universal for all the genome?
So all different kinds of things happen. So sometimes there will be a big intron, and within that intron there might be another gene. Okay, some genes are totally intronless, like they won't have any introns, they will have only exons. Okay, and sometimes what you can have, you have two strands, no, the plus and the minus strand, they go in the opposite direction. So sometimes one strand may code for one gene, on the other strand it might be coding for another gene. So this strand, yeah, there will be an intron, but the gene which is coded by the other strand, that same DNA sequence may not be an intron, it may be an exon of that gene. So that is why in your DNA sequencing, it is important to know, is it the plus or the minus strand that you are sequencing. We call it as the sense and the antisense strand, because sometimes the sense strand codes for one gene, the antisense codes for one gene. And so it will be the intron of the sense strand gene, but it may be the exon of the antisense strand gene. Okay, so keep this in mind. It is for, not for all genes, but a few genes, especially those genes which are big genes, this is known to happen. Like NF1, neurofibromatosis is a very big gene. And there are genes within gene which are coded on the antisense strand. So it's always, that's why whichever gene you're working with, it's always good to go into these databases, UCSC or Ensemble, and try and find out more about that particular region, because still we don't understand fully the whole thing. So it's always good to go and check exactly what is coding, which strand is coding for what.
I have one question. So when we go to the Ensemble, whenever we go to Ensemble and look for one specific gene, there are n number of transcripts present for that particular gene. So like for TERT, there are more than 10. Transcript variants. So which one should we choose, which is the best we should go for it, and how to understand which one will be coding our particular gene so that we can design our experiment around it?
So if you look in Ensemble, in front of the transcript ID, it will be written, is it a protein coding or is it it undergoes decay. There are some transcripts which undergo decay, so those transcripts are not even going to be seen in your wet lab experiment, so you should totally disregard them. As a there's no rule regarding this, but as a general rule, what we follow is that we always choose the biggest transcript. Ideally, you should choose the most abundant transcript, but that data may or may not be present for every gene. But if you're working on one particular gene, ideally it will be good, you try and check which is the most abundant transcript in the cells that you are working with. That will be the best one. So that is why from the diagnostic point of view, this becomes very important which transcript you are choosing, because the cDNA numbering will change depending on what transcript you are using. So any diagnostic report that we give, we always mention the transcript ID and then you mention the mutation. Okay, so that is very important to keep in mind. Whenever you say C.843C2T, that 843 might be something else in one transcript and something else in the other. So always it's good to mention the transcript ID when you describe a mutation.
I hope if somebody else have more questions for sir or Priya.
Ma'am, I want to ask sir only. Sir, I wanted to ask that in case of introns, earlier it was said that introns are not important regions, but then it came out that introns are really important and snRNA and snoRNAs are being formed from the intronic region. So how are these RNAs being transcribed from introns? Like introns also have promoter regions from where that transcription start, or how is it going on?
That's right. So we are slowly getting to know about these non-coding RNAs, they are called as a group. So these non-coding RNAs are the ones which are basically involved in the gene regulation. So earlier what we used to think as junk DNA, now we know that all that extra DNA that we have, which is non-coding, is mainly involved in regulation. And that is why if you see, earthworm and humans have almost the same number of genes. But yes, the main difference is in the non-coding genome. And so slowly we are now understanding that the non-coding genome is the one which is regulating these genes. And so in that way, it plays a major role. So these non-coding RNAs also will have their own promoters and they will be transcribed in the same way. Only they don't code for a protein, but they are involved in the regulation of either transcription or translation, whatever is involved.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
So thank you, Priya, for a wonderful presentation, and thank you, sir, for enlightening us about the integrated information about the replication and mRNAs and the genetic information, which is important for diagnosis of genetic disease and also for the therapeutics. So with this, we end today's biology talk, and we'll meet on 11th for another of the talks of biology series. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.